morning.
Glad to have you back.
Yeah, yeah, nice to see you, Jersey, in sunny America, East Coast or West Coast, where you are. No.
Oh, Amsterdam coast. I'm waiting for the
bike. You're still Amsterdam, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So everybody out there who's listening, and if you weren't on yesterday morning, Yossi is the United States Chief High Performance Officer. He's just been hired over the new year, and he's got a lot on his plate to figure out the American system and see what we can do to improve it.
Yeah, so, well done. Congratulations, Jersey. I've seen it.
Thank you very much, Valerie.
Last year, yeah.
I was looking at your presentation. It's going to be interesting again.
Yeah.
Your PowerPoint. I'm a cheater. I checked your PowerPoint before.
Well, that's another point to make to everybody is that the PowerPoints are all, if you haven't seen them, all the PowerPoints are available on the platform, and they're yours to take with you. You can use them. The videos will be up probably in a week. The links to all the presentations will be up, so you can go and see those whenever you want for 6 months, and then Skedge.com kicks us out. So, but we will keep the links to all the videos post 6 months. So if there's anything you ever need to see or want to go back, I had somebody ask me a couple of days ago, do I have Tom Terhar's presentation from Jim Joy in 2005? And so, so you can call and there's a good chance we'll have it in the warehouse.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. By the way, I updated my presentation this morning, just added a couple of slides. So please download, and I put it on the same location at Google Drive, just upload on the same link.
Great. So then everybody will have the updated one anyways. Yeah. So gentlemen, do you mind if we want to get rolling here? Okay, well then we'll start now. Good morning, everybody. It's great to have you all back. Thanks so much for taking part in the conference. We have a great way to start off the day. Larry Klezhnev is here with us and about a topic we all love and argue about constantly. So I'm excited to hear this. Valerie, you said something interesting. You said that although we have four styles, main styles, you think we're down to two now in the world of rowing. So it'd be interesting to hear you talk about that. Eric Gerke is here and will host this presentation for the rest of it. So he will introduce all the questions to Dr. Klezhnev. I hope that everybody has a great time and takes a lot away. So if you have questions, please put them in the Q&A or the chat, and Eric will get to those. And I hope you have an enjoyable rest of the day. Let's have some fun. Welcome.
Yeah. Okay, thanks, Chris. So can I start? Yeah. Yeah. So I'll share my screen, optimize for video. So the title today is Rowing Styles. What is the most optimal style and considerations? The content actually is pretty simple. I'll show you some definitions, basic concepts, and basic principles of effective rowing technique, some recently developed rowing indicators. Then we will have a look at the examples of rowing styles in the world's best rowers. And then hopefully we have some time for questions and discussions, maybe not, maybe we can do it online later. So the starting point, the definition and classification. Of course, some coaches argue that's all not really relevant. There's only two rowing styles, my rowing style and incorrect rowing style. But we try to be a little bit more scientific. We try to, to see some features or some points of rowing styles. And my starting point is a very popular classification of rowing styles introduced by Peter Klauerer, I think Canadian coach and sports scientist in 1979, quite a long time ago. And that time, it's actually more than 40 years ago now, he defined three rowing styles, Adam rowing style, DDR rowing style, and Rosenberg. And it became quite popular, and you can see the references on this, his publication in quite many articles. And then I started somewhere in early in 2000 after in Australia. I was in Australia and working for then for Australian Institute of Sport, then in UK. I start thinking about what similarities, what differences in between these rowing styles. And I found that there are the two factors here. Firstly, timing, simultaneous timing, legs and trunk, the same time together, working together. And then sequential timing, legs first, then trunk. And of course, rowing style, it's always all about power production using two biggest and the most powerful muscle groups, legs and trunks. Someone can argue there are some other features of rowing style, say rhythm or recovery sequence or whatever, or blade work. Yeah, but this is a traditional classification, and all based on the coordination of two biggest muscle groups, legs and trunks, and trunk. And the second factor here is emphasis. And I simply put it's quite popular method as well, method of quadrant. I put on x-axis, horizontal axis timing, simultaneous on the left, sequential timing on the right, and on y-axis emphasis, legs emphasis, quite long legs drive at the bottom, and trunk emphasis at the top. And these three rowing styles fit quite nicely, these three quadrants, DJR rowing style, simultaneous timing, emphasis on the trunk, quite long trunk work, Rosenberg style, similar long trunk work, but sequential timing, legs first. And Adam style, short trunk, very long legs. If you remember that it was became popular when longer slides were introduced somewhere in the 70s, and simultaneous timing. And one quadrant was empty. And I start thinking what rowing style can fit this area. And I found that probably Ivanov, Igor Grinko was my good friend. If you remember, that was a very successful coach from Ukraine, from Russia, and then he worked in the US, very successfully in China. And origin, I think we can call it Ivanov, three times Olympic champion single sculler. And I think they have quite similar rowing styles, and this legs emphasis, not very long trunk work, but sequential timing, legs first and trunk. And of course, that's not easy to find the pure, clear example of rowing style. There's some, most of them a mixture, something in between, but I tried to find them. And what I also tried to do, this is just hypothetical power curves. This from my experience, they do not belong to any crew or rower. This is my observation, how it look like. DDR rowing style, usually they have quite, rectangular shape of the power curve, and you see the velocities here, legs and trunk working together. And these days, you know, DJR doesn't exist anymore, but Jürgen Grobler, he is from DJR, and I think he practiced this style in his British crews, and one of the examples, this Olympic champions Andy Hodge, Pete Reed, Chris Williams, and other. You can see quite massive trunk, quite long inclination of the trunk, and the legs and trunk works together straight away after catch. I think this could be example of DJR rowing style now. Rosenberg Rovin style, I think most of Italian crews practice this style, legs first, then trunk and quite long trunk work. But I think Mehi Drysdale is a good example. You see quite long legs first and then massive trunk activity. Actually, you can find many single scholars practice this style because in big boards, it's not really efficient, you know, this long trunk work, it takes a lot of energy with higher speed. It could be not efficient. In big boards, we can see now sometimes the Adams style. The typical example, this German quote, this is from Sydney Olympics. You see this guy on the stroke seat. His trunk basically vertical at catch, and he just opened the trunk straight away after catch. And this makes, I think, his legs drive really, really heavy and hard. Yeah, but I think this is quite many actually German crews still use this rowing style. Another example, some seats in the German eight, say seat four, seat three, seat five, a little bit different, more GGR style, but you see that's quite vertical position of the trunk and they open the trunk straight away after the catch. Right, and by the way, talking about the power curve, usually from my experience, Rosenberg style produce quite high peak, but triangular shape of the power curve. Adam style also more rectangular. Actually, when you use legs and trunk simultaneously, the power curve became, you know, more rectangular, but not so high peak usually. And Ivanov Grinko-Rovin style, I can show you original video of Vyacheslav Ivanov, famous single scholar. You see that time it was quite short slides, but I think it's quite optimal position of the trunk, legs first and then trunk straight away and not very long work of the trunk. Quite compact drive, fast legs drive. You see legs first and then trunk. I think it's quite efficient rowing style. Another example, you know, Igor Grinko coached Yuri Janssen, silver Olympic medalist in Athens, I think. I think quite similar. Legs first and not very long trunk. I think these days quite many scholars practice this style, not very long trunk. I think it's quite popular. This style is quite popular now. And power curve with this style usually quite fast force the power gradient after catch, high peak, but it's more triangular because second half usually is slightly weaker here. Okay, then of course you want me to say something about which style is better, which one is more effective. But this is not a simple, no simple answer on this simple question. And to start thinking and start discussing it, we need to find out what actually are criteria of efficiency. And many coaches still believe that this is continuous board movement. They're talking about all the board check, don't stop the board at catch, keep the board running, blah, 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 all these things, etc. And when I started analyzing the board movement, and of course the board acceleration is the main indicator of the board movement. and I developed this pattern classification or definitions of the pattern of the Boat acceleration. It's always look like this: deep negative peak at catch, because the rover pushed the stretch. And I start analyzing different crews, different rovers. I found the better crews, better rovers always have deeper and narrower negative peak at catch. Always, no exemptions, no from this rule. And then they usually have quite fast increasing of the acceleration, quite steep gradient, and then they have that what we call first peak of the boat acceleration. That was found in sweep and scullion boards, singles and crew boards, and so the pattern was quite similar. A deep but narrow negative peak. Here you can see comparison of two board types, men's pair at 39 stroke per minute, Olympic champions red, and some national level crew is blue. You see the difference. And then a lightweight men's double, also Olympic champions red, national level blue. You see that national level, they don't have the first peak at all. They have basically quite shallow negative peak and then slow increase of acceleration. And I start thinking how it works, and I learned a lot from this crew, Tompkins, Dean, Australians, men's pair. And I came to the concept, what I call trampoline effect. And because there's some similarities between roving and trampoline jumping. In both cases, we need to accelerate center of mass of the athlete, because the athlete, the rover, is the heaviest part of the system, much heavier than the board. So it's the most important to accelerate the center of mass of the rover. And I found that when the force increases quickly and rover performs sort of bouncing movement from the stretch at catch, firstly, it helps utilization of elastic energy of the muscles, ligaments, and increases efficiency. And this really important principle, biomechanical principle. By the way, like, for example, in sprint running, 90% of the energy comes from elastic properties of the muscles, only 10% added by muscle contraction. Of course, rowing is different. It's not so fast. We can't achieve 90%, but I think some maybe 10, 15% is still good. And also it's important that ground in rowing is our stretcher, foot stretcher, because that's where we apply the stretcher force and accelerate the center of mass of the rower, you see here. It must be moving after catch, not stationary. And this helps to improve acceleration of the rover center of mass. So in this way, it works like a trampoline, but of course, it's not real trampoline. There is no trampoline that's based on the firm ground. We have no ground. In rowing, the board always moves and it's light. Yeah, but we have to create that support which on the stretch which starts moving fast after catch and then accelerate center of mass of the rower. And this is the main target of the drive. And it's also important consequence from this concept is that bouncing in crew boards must be synchronous. That's absolutely important. You cannot jump on the trampoline asynchronously. If you have two athletes jumping asynchronously, they cancel effect of the bouncing of the trampoline. They can't jump at all. It's useless. And here are some examples of rowing of what we call this trampoline effect. Just watch the rhythm. It's really fast legs drive. And the verbal expression legs must be fast but light. And it looks like really easy, this throwing style, right? Basically effortless. Rowing, that's what gives us efficiency. That's what means efficiency. If you see something heavy, running or skiing or whatever, rowing, that means inefficient. Efficient usually looks easy and effortless, but of course not for athletes. They apply a lot of efforts and power. And without trampoline, there is comparison. Basically, this is curves of this pair and this single scholar. And you see the difference in the rhythm. This is slow, and then you can see acceleration. Slow and acceleration. And comparing, for example, acceleration, we can see the blue curve is a single scholar. There is no first peak here. And basically, board velocity stays at low level, basically all the way during the drive. And it's no trampoline effect here. It's another important concept of rowing efficiency is power transfer. And many coaches think when you push the stretcher, you stop the board. This is negative force. In fact, it's not. It's not negative. It's not stopping the board. Firstly, the stretcher force internal between rower and the board and does not affect the system movement at all. You know very well if you sit in the board without using the oars, just keeping them flat on water, and just move on the seat, push on the stretcher, you won't move anywhere. And so this internal force, it does not affect, you won't move forward, but you won't move backwards as well. And in rowing, the power is transferred through both handle and the stretcher in proportion about 60 through the handle, 40 through the stretcher. And very simple example, like if you do squats, your feet are fixed, power transfer through feet, your feet is zero, all power transferred through upper body. When you do a similar exercise on the machine, leg press, in this case, your upper body is fixed, all power is transferred through your feet. And power, just to remind you, is product of the force and velocity. If velocity is zero, power is zero. You can apply as much force as you want. The power would be zero if the point of force application is stationary, if it doesn't move. In rowing, we have movement at both handle and the stretcher. Stretch always moves, board accelerates, decelerates relative to the rower. And rower actually also moves relative to the stretcher. That's why rower produce power through both handle and the stretcher. And this is not negative power because it transferred straight away through the board hole, through the rigger to the gate and then pin gate and then to the collar of the oar, to the middle of the oar, and then it produces propulsive force at the blade. And to produce that blade force, we need this pair of force, handle and stretcher. And it's not possible to produce blade force without one of them. So it's stretcher force is absolutely necessary for propulsive force in rowing. Another example for better understanding how it works, comparison with kayaking. In kayaking, we also have an oar. We have three points. We have the blade. Then we have the middle of the oar, and then the end point. So when the kayaker paddling, he pushes with outside arm and pulls with inside arm. And that always action force always create reaction force, and actually this reaction force is moves the whole system forward. At the blade, it moves the whole system relative to the athletes, pulling action, produce reaction force, which pulls the whole the athlete center of mass forward. And I'm showing this just to show you that in rowing, the stretcher works as a pulling arm. When we push the stretcher, we accelerate center of mass of the rower forward. This is really important. The rower, the heaviest and the most important part of the system. And also when we pull the handle, we pull the center of mass of the rower backwards. And we stop acceleration of the rover center of mass. And that's why it's not efficient to pull the handle straight away. You just need to hold it, create center of point of support at the handle and work through the stretcher. And finally, I came to this concept, what I call catch through the stretcher. And basically there is a most traditional oldest concept, what is called catch through the handle. Many rowers and coaches still think that's only way to do the catch, because it's quite obvious what we need to do at catch. We need to change direction of the oar movement, right? Handle from the stern to the bow. And it's obvious that the oar rotates around the pin. And most of the people think that the only way to change direction is to pull the handle. And this creates all sorts of problems. You know, you have to do it fast at catch. And also you need to change direction of the quite heavy mass of the rower and the board relative to the board. And if you try to pull the handle, you have to grab the arms or open the trunk too early. So there is another way of thinking about catch, is what I call catch through the stretch. In this way, you think that fulcrum or center of rotation is your handle. And it makes sense from the rower point of view, not from, of course, not from the coach point of view, because the handle always moves if you see it from the side. But from the rower, if you just imagine that you are rower and you watch your handle at catch, it shouldn't move relative to your eyes, relative to your head and your body, your trunk. Just hold it and just, you can look at it and it's stationary. And when rower kicked the stretcher or bounced from the stretcher, that force immediately transferred through the board, trigger, pin, gate, and push the oar in the middle. And remember, catch, it's always about when the blade is still in the air. It's not in the water. We're talking about changing direction. You cannot put the blade in the water until the blade starts moves backwards to the stern. Otherwise you create the breaking force, backsplash, and you basically, you stop the whole system from moving forward. So here we're talking about the air, when the blade in the air part before the drive. And catch to the stretcher gives you advantage, because when you kick the stretcher and try to change direction in this way of the oar, you use longer outboard. You push the oar in the middle, hold the handle, and you use the whole length of the oar basically. And other way, if you pull the handle, you use shorter inboard, right? And this catch to the stretch, you can get 46% quicker increase of velocity and faster acceleration of the blade. That means you can achieve velocity of the water relative to the board quicker and connect to the water earlier. And this gives you advantage, first advantage. And probably the most important is that catch to the stretcher allows you to use, firstly, bounce, use elastic properties of the muscles, and also use the most powerful muscle groups and accelerate center of mass of the rower. This is what is called rowing using the rower weight. And from here, we can start moving to next principle, what I call hammer and nail principle. It's all about acceleration of the masses. Comparison here is very simple. When you try to insert the nail, if you just put the hammer on the nail and push, nothing happened, right? So you have to accelerate the hammer first and then hit the nail. So basically what happens, you separate the acceleration and action, power production or effect of the of your action. And similar in rowing, when someone tried to create propulsive force and accelerate center of mass of the rower at the same time, it's really ineffective. And the red curve here shows you example of rowing technique in this style. You see that very often we have a loop, that means basically that's breaking force. This is some backsplash here, and then force increases slower, but with some aggressive and really fast trunk activation, you can achieve some peak force early. But then what happens very often, we have what we call broken force curve, that, or in other words, disconnection between trunk, legs and trunk, because trunk already moving, legs are not, and then rover try to squeeze legs, and it's really awkward and uncomfortable movement, and usually there is the force curve is broken. Here, basically, you can see it, and here, even here, the rhythm just two time broken drive and in two parts. And other way around, when you accelerate the center of mass first and then apply the power to the blade, you have that nice bell-shaped force curve without any jerks or double picking. And that means your drive is really solid, connected, and really efficient. The last, probably the principle we can use to define effective rowing style is what we call two joint muscles or biarticulate muscles. The thing is that muscles of both front surface of the legs, quads, and back surface, hamstrings and glutes, they basically biarticulate. That means they connected around two joints, hips and knees. You see some anatomy pictures here. For the front surface, the sartorius connected to the pelvis and then goes around the knee and connected to the shins from the inside front. From the backside and hamstrings, there is semitendinosus. These muscles also connected to the pelvis at the back and to the shins from the backside. And when someone uses this Adam rowing style, and at this position, the sharp knee angle, and the athlete try to open the trunk, these muscles must be activated, semitendinosus, and basically what they do, they prevent knee extension. So opening the trunk at this position prevent knee extension, and this makes the legs drive even harder, even heavier. So basically one muscle group, hamstrings and glutes, work against another one, against quads, which try to extend the knee. And this is really inefficient. And I think this rowing style, Adam rowing style, is quite inefficient in terms of muscle coordination. It's really, really hard for legs drive. And I'm sure these guys suffer a lot with their quads. They burned straight away after probably half of the race. And probably the last concept, which is important for rowing style, for definition of rowing style, is concept of transition point, which I developed somewhere in 2008. And I started actually that time, I tried to analyze all that coordination of legs and trunk and try to understand why some rowers have that, you know, double picking, they have broken foreskirt. And I found that that gap or break in the foreskirt usually happens in this position, knee angle 90 degrees, handle on top of the stretcher. And usually the rower places the heels on the footboard at this time. And it changes the whole biomechanics of the force and power transmission and rowing, because before this position at catch, the rower pushes the stretcher through the toes. And it's the best way to start the drive is to use your quads and extend your knee, accelerate your body weight, center of mass. And then at transition point, what happens? And actually before transition point, if you try to open the trunk, what happens? You push your knee down and this automatically collapses the knee. After transition point, when you push your knee down, it's automatically extend the knee. And in 2008, we've done some electromyography measurements with the best rowers. We found that some of the best rowers, they managed to even to relax the quads after transition point and knee still extending by means of glutes and hamstrings. And that's, I think it's really, really important because, you know, the quads are really hardworking muscle in rowing, and they are not big muscles. By the way, even in cycling, 60% of the power is produced by hamstrings and glutes. They are much bigger muscles than the quads. So it's important to use that bottom back part of the leg, hamstrings and glutes. And we can do it after transition point. We can relax the quads, open the hips, and pushing the knee down, we automatically extend the both hips and knee. And using this concept, I found that the transition point is the best position to start using the trunk in rowing. So that means before from catch to transition point, legs only, knee extension, pushing through the toes. Also important because it decreases lift force on the seat. You won't lose your seat. Otherwise, if you push through the heels, you can just simply jump, lift your weight from the seat and lose it. And at transition point, you can start, you can actually, the rowers have to switch really quickly from knee extension to hips extension, from quads to hamstrings, and start opening the trunk in one continuous movement without any breaking of the force, and switch to hamstrings and glutes. And this is joint extension of the hips and knee. And this is really powerful part of the drive. And then that would be it about the definitions and basic concept. Then we need to find some indicators, you know, because I'm always continuously doing biomechanical measurements. We measure force.
Doctor. Curve.
Yep.
A question just before you kind of move on to this section, because it applies to the different types. A really thoughtful one was asking if you could address the difference in a rower's trunk and limb proportions and how that might affect the rowing style they choose.
Yeah, it's a very good question. And that's what I found. I found that many lightweight and female rowers with quite short, with short legs, they use more simultaneous rowing style. They open the trunk earlier. And I think, and especially in big boats, in the fours and the eights. And I think it's also related to the speed of the handle, because in big boats, the handle speed is faster, and legs only, especially when the rower is not very tall, with short legs, legs extension is not enough to provide sufficient handle speed. That means these rowers must open the trunk earlier. That's a good question. That's the common principle I found. And other way around, you see example of Mahi Drysdale, big heavyweight male rowers with long legs. They have enough leg speed, and especially in small boats and the single, so they can use legs first and then basically open the trunk very, very late. That's the common principle, I think.
And do you see any changes in foot stretcher height with the different, the four different styles?
Well, it's different question, difficult question, because, you know, to be honest, I just don't have enough data about the stretcher height and position, and in my practical work, I just don't have time to measure all these variables. But from just common sense, I think if you put the stretcher higher, you can push more horizontally, yeah, but also you are sitting more upright. You probably won't be to use sort of DGR style with long inclination of the trunk, because when you lift the stretcher up, you also lift up your knee, and it's more difficult to get enough compression on the trunk, you know. And yeah, that's probably the principle. You would use more upright position of the trunk, sort of Adam or Ivanov Grinko style. I think it's efficient in terms of horizontal force application, but it also makes the drive shorter at cage, and you may have some difficulties in compression, you know, approaching the cage. If you put the stretcher lower, you can row longer, because the knees goes down as well together with the stretcher. And you can use longer trunk, sort of DGR rowing style, but the negative part is that your force is more directed downwards, and you're not so horizontal, and that increases sport vertical movement, and could be not very efficient as well. Yeah, so it must be optimal.
Yeah, thank you. And Yosi asked a follow-up to that one, just asking how would angle also play, foot stretcher angle, not just height.
For stretcher angle plays similar role, the stretcher height. If it's too shallow, it's look like low, high stretcher, because you lift your ankle joint up, and you can, I think some rowers, I think Ole Zeidler, they always keep the heels in contact, I think, with the stretcher. That means they have no transition point. They just can open the trunk straight away, push the knee down. Actually, they start the drive at transition point. I don't think it's really efficient, because we need longer drive just to accelerate body weight and just to increase power. Otherwise, shorter drive, that means less power. Yeah, so it must be optimal, but too steep stretcher also can create the problem with approach and the catch with flexibility of the ankle joint. So again, I think must be optimal. And what we have now, 40, 42 degrees, I think it's optimal for the most of the rowers.
Great. Thank you so much. Sorry to, perfect time to stop.
Okay, so the next part is evaluation of the rowing styles. We need some indicators. And originally, when we did biomechanical measurements, we simply measured handle velocity from oar angle derived from the oar angle. And then we measured seat velocity, red curve on this chart, and handle is black. Also, in small boards, we measured trunk and arms velocity, but this is not so important here. So the main point here to look at is coordination of the handle and seat at catch. There is inside the circle, there is a catch vertical line is where the handle changes direction. This is definition of the catch. And I just noticed that some rowers change direction. Change direction means crossing horizontal zero axis. And because negative part is the recovery, the seat and the handle moves backwards, negative velocity. Then when they cross that horizontal line, zero axis, actually x-axis, that means they change direction and positive part is the drive, the handle and the seat moves forward towards this bow. And I just noticed that coordination is different. Some rowers change direction on the seat first. Some of them really close together, seat and trunk, seat and handle nearly the same time. And some of them, number three, single skull and number three here, you see this athlete changes direction first on the handle and then on the seat. And that was my explanation. Look at this curve, you do this and you do that, but it was really uncertain because there could be more or less the timing difference, more or less. And then somewhere in 2017, 4 years ago, 5 years ago, I developed what I call catch factor. So with some a little bit mathematical tricks, I managed to define that time between moments when this handle and the seat change direction quite accurately, down to 1 millisecond. And I found that optimal value is somewhere minus 15 to minus 25 milliseconds. This is 0.015 second, really short time. Basically, it's half video frame. And by this time, the seat should change direction earlier than the handle. And this is good indication of what we call catch through the stretcher and acceleration of the rover center of mass. And I found the most of the successful rovers use this style, this technique. And this allows, again, acceleration of the rover center of mass. If some rowers have the time positive, that means seat changes direction after the handle, later than the handle. And usually these rowers rolling back the trunk or grab the arms, that means they pull the handle before they change direction on the seat. I also found that extremely negative values below say 50 milliseconds also not good. That means not really slight shooting, but changing direction on the seat too early. And basically this is just losing the distance and the movement of the wasting the leg's power because the seat starts moving long time before the handle. And this is also not very effective. That means the catch factor must be optimal, and the optimal range, I think something from -5 down to -35-40 milliseconds, and anything outside this range could be not effective. But of course, there is some exception, and I'll show you some good rovers. These days, they still manage to have it somewhere close to zero and to be successful, but they could be even more. My point is that very often the crews are winning, not because, but in spite of the technique, you know it very well. If they have enormous power and very good motivation, they can overcome the technical problems. And the second indicator here is what we call roving style factor. And if the catch factor, it was all about timing, it's basically the catch is when the blade is still in the air, it's not the drive, it's only changing direction. Roving style factor is about the movement, about beginning of the drive, how legs sit, moves relative to the handle, how they work together, what coordination they have. And what I've done, I simply found that transition point usually happens at about 20% of the drive length. And with sensors, we can easily define, measure movement of the seat and the handle from catch to this point. If we divide one by another, seat movement by the handle movement, we get percentage. If we would have 100%, that means seat moves exactly the same distance as the handle. And this is actually a definition of roving style factor, ratio of the seat to the handle movement from catch to transition point, or first 20% of the drive. And I found the optimal value here is about 90%. That means 10% of the handle movement provided by upper body, and 90% the main contribution comes from legs. Values of roving style factor below 80% means grabbing the arms or shoulders or too early opening the trunk. That means legs moves or seat moves less, slower, and upper body contributes more. But values more than 100%, it always also happens quite often. This also not good. That means legs are going off too fast. This is what is called bump shoving or slide shooting. And this is real losing of the power through weaker back. That means legs produce more power, and that power consumed for bending the trunk. It's not effective. So optimal range here from 80 to 100%. This is optimal range for roving style factor. And just to make the picture complete, I also made what is called finish factor. And here's very briefly, this is a finish factor just before, but before I briefly explain you the main principle of the finish, because it's also important. And if catch must be done only through the stretcher, finish, good finish must be done only through the handle. This only way to complete the drive and return the change direction of the body movement of the rower and start for recovery. And the main principles here is that only finish through the handle creates additional force at the blade, because you pull the blade and this propels the whole system, board rover system forward. If you just change direction through the stretcher, nothing happens. You remember the stretcher force, it's an internal one. It doesn't contribute anything to the movement of the whole system. So that's the most important point, that only finish through the handle allows you to still produce some propulsive force. Another important advantage is that you see that center of moving mass of the rover, you see it at some level, some height from the stretcher. And this distance creates a leverage. And inertia force on the of the trunk, when we try to stop that inertia, it creates the torque, which must be balanced on the seat. And if we try to return that mass change direction through the stretcher, it creates the pair of the force and very high downwards force on the seat, which could be 50-70% higher than the rover weight. And this pushes the board down, and you see for the rovers and crews with that massive trunk work, and then finish through the stretcher, they push the board down, and you see a lot of waves and bouncing of the board, which is not effective. And a few other points here that, for example, relaxation of the quads muscles and other things. So the finish must be done only through the handle, and it's also must be quite short counter movement. That means finish factor, it's also about the time between moments of the stop in the trunk or shoulders. Trunk means shoulders and the handle at finish. And optimal value is minus 50 milliseconds. That means the trunk or shoulders should overtake stop and the handle. So it's very short counter movement. We change direction on the shoulders first, start moving through the handle, start moving the mass backwards to recovery, and then change direction on the handle. If we have a positive finish factor, that means handle going back to the stern, but trunk still going forward to the bow. And this was sort of throwing the trunk at the finish. Some, I know in America, some, especially in sweep rowing, at low rate, quite many rowers like to do that, just keep going with the shoulders while the handle already going back. I don't think it's efficient. And also you can't do it at high stroke rate simply because you just don't have time for it. And it requires a lot of energy for you from the rover to return the trunk through the stretch. But extremely negative values also not so good. Say below minus 100 milliseconds means widen the trunk around the handle. That means the rower stopped the trunk too early, and basically handle still moving forward to the bow, but trunk sort of winding around the handle. And it's a loss of the power. And usually that means stop pushing the stretcher, put the weight on the seat, and basically losing the force at the finish of the drive. But this finish factor, we can measure it only in small boards because to measure it, we need to measure movement of the shoulders or on the rowing machine. It's a quite good indicator as well. And just to summarize the first part, I just put forward the five main principles of effective rowing technique. Catch through the stretcher first. Catch factor is good indicator. Correct rowing style. Sequence of the body segments, legs, trunk, arms is the most effective sequence. Finish through the handle. We have another indicator, finish factor here, that means use kinetic energy through the handle and transfer it to the blade. The force curve must be front loaded, fat and smooth. That's basically a consequence of correct rowing technique. And I consider the force curve is sort of resultant indicator. Usually you cannot just to draw the force curve, whatever you like. You have to practice proper sequence of the segments, proper movement, acceleration, then you have nice force curve. And the fifth, but not last, also very important, rhythm and relaxation. Micro pause after the finish, I think it helps. Firstly, mainly for relaxation, for good breathing, pardon, breath, taking the oxygen into your lungs after the drive. And also, if you should not rush for recovery, because rushing beginning of recovery means pulling the stretcher, acceleration of the board forward. And this is the main consumption of the energy for the drug. When it's because, you know, that cubic proportion of the board hole velocity and drag power. And the most of the drag power is lost at highest velocity, not when you stop the board at catch. Because when you stop the board, you have very low board velocity and low drag resistance. But when you pull it after the finish, that's where we can lose energy on the drag a little bit more than necessary and increase variation of the board speed. Now, just a few examples, just to give you illustration of correct rowing style. I think this famous crew, legendary crew, you know them very well, this is Kiwi pair. I think they are good illustration of that catch factor and rowing style. Just watch the catch technique. That really, you can see that counter movement, especially in Eric Murray, the bow guy. You see the seat already starts moving to the bow, handle still moving to the stern. This is a catch factor. Seat changes direction first, and Hamish Bond as well. Counter movement, handle to the stern, seat to the bow. That means acceleration. Firstly, it's bouncing from the stretcher, acceleration of the rover center of mass. And just watch how much the seat travels till the blade fully covered into the water. You see that New Zealand label on the board, and just watch. Legs, about 10 centimeters seat movement, no trunk, straight arms hanging on the handle. They do not pull the handle, just hold it. Legs only, trunk angle nearly constant. And here, I think somewhere here is transition point, knee angle 90 degrees, handle on top of the stretcher. And this is a point, the best position to start opening the trunk. And this is what they do. Pushing knee down, hips extension. And this is really powerful movement, because the biggest muscles involved. Perpendicular position of the oar. You see legs nearly straight, trunk is nearly vertical, arms still straight. Here they start bending the trunk and approaching the finish. And at the finish, you can see again, quite short counter movement. Shoulders start moving backwards, handle still going forward to the bow. This is finish factor.
Doctor, there's a question that kind of works itself around what you mentioned here, the amount that the seat traveled before the blade finished entering. Someone asked at the juniors level, so you know, U19 and under, could it be argued that a slight overcompression of the legs at the catch would allow the time for the blade to enter through the stretchers without giving up that much on the slide, since the knees got so compressed?
I don't think over compression, you mean going shins over the vertical. I don't think it's a good idea, simply because it's not efficient for knee extension. You see, these guys, they keep shins vertical at cage. This is the best position. I'm not sure for juniors, but I think even for juniors, I wouldn't not recommend it, because when shins going over the vertical, that means when you push the stretcher, the force goes down, right? Simply because, you know, the force decomposition. And also it makes really hard job for your quads and for your joints. I don't think it's a good idea. I think the best position for the catch is shins vertical. Thigh angle about 45 degrees. This is the best position for the catch.
Great. No more. Yeah, keeping the knees safe, right?
Yeah, so. Keeping the knees safe. And biomechanically, that's the most efficient, because overcompression is really hard. It could injury risk increases. And And another good example is Sam Matvik, the current Olympic champion. This is quite old video from 2014, but I don't think she changed her technique. You see quite good compression, because she has probably quite long legs, but shins are still vertical. Just maybe a little bit over the vertical, but not much. And you see counter movement, seat starts moving. And here it's very good example. Emma, we can see a really good hanging on the handle, no shoulders movement at all. Legs only, acceleration of the body weight. I think somewhere here, she has sort of small slide shooting or bump shoving. I think here seat moves faster than the handle. So I would estimate her rowing style factor somewhere slightly higher than 100%, because here you see that seat moves slightly faster than the handle. But I don't think it's a big problem here, because it's really efficient, fast legs drive. And I think she's supposed to start using the trunk somewhere here at transition point, but she does it slightly later here. Hips extension, still hanging on the handle. Vertical trunk, legs nearly finished. And then counter slight finish factor, counter movement and finish. And I can show you much more examples, and they're all very similar. I think it's another current Olympic champions, Dutch quad. Slightly grabbing the arms in the stroke seat, but I think seat three is a good example. Catch factor, seat starts moving before the handle, hanging on the handles, transition point, opening the trunk, and not very long trunk drive and finish factor. Yeah, I think this, I can show you more examples, that, but I think they all quite similar. The old best rowers, they use that principles. Catch through the stretcher, that British also double Olympic champions, hanging on the handle, legs first, and then transition point, opening the trunk. And then finish factor, changing direction through the handle at finish. Right, and basically now we nearly spent 70 minutes. So I have basically analysis of all Olympic champions from Tokyo Olympics. I think you can study, learn it from the slides. I'm just briefly mention a couple of crews. It was not easy to do that analysis because of low quality video. Not really consistent frame rate, but the focus was Rowan style factor, the sequence of the body segments, and you can clearly see on that pictures during the drive and recovery, which is also important. And only some indirect and uncertain evaluation can be made for the catch factor. And the single scholar, the Greek guy, you see here the what we focus on. We mark the catch, that pink line is a position, yellow line is a position of the trunk at catch. And then we compare the trunk angle during the drive and during transition point is the trunk angle at catch, because it's the yellow line, angle of yellow line stays the same in all pictures. And then we can see how the trunk works during the drive and the position at the finish. Recovery transition point exists on also on recovery, not only during the drive. And I think it's important to get trunk ready for the catch and for the drive at this position during recovery. This is some principle, what we call mirror principle of the sequence of the body segments. During the drive, it must be legs, trunk, arms. During recovery, arms, body slide, arms, trunk, legs. If trunk is not ready, we call it sort of diving into the catch. The rower try to move the shoulders forward and overtake the seat at catch. Usually this rower start the drive with trunk as well. That means it's not correct sequence. That means to get trunk ready at this position also important. That's why we analyze it here. And you see it's nearly ready for the catch from transition point at the during recovery to the catch, basically no trunk movement. And then legs first, only slightly opening the trunk. That means rowing style looks, I would estimate some 90% rowing style factor. And perpendicular position of the oar, vertical trunk, nearly straight legs, straight arms. I think it's good position. And then not very long trunk, reasonably long, I would say, at the finish. This rowing style with catch factor, I can't say much. It looked like it's slightly earlier pulling the handle, but you know the frame rate is variable here. It's very difficult to estimate. Just looking at the shoulders, I think it's a little bit grabbing the shoulders in this color, but really long and powerful hips extension here you see, and also very fast legs drive using fat oars blades, by the way. Emmett Wick we already discussed, good position during recovery, and basically the same trunk angle at transition point, very fast legs drive. Even you see at this picture, you see slightly bump shooting. Yeah, but I would estimate the rowing style about slightly more than 100%, and catch factor, I think it's quite efficient here. And okay, I think we already spent 75 minutes. Very briefly, I will go to the summary point, basically to this slide.
Just because you mentioned the blade type that the Greek single sculler used, we did have a question about what's the best C2 blade type that you would recommend for the recommended rowing style you just spoke about.
Yeah, that's very good question. Thanks, Eric. But my answer would be, we're still working on it. You know, we have this concept too. We have a project and I developed a lot of new sensors to measure all sorts of variables from the blade. It looked like comp blades quite efficient, surprisingly. The efficiency is not, at least not worse than smoothie. This fat, I think, firstly, we found that you shouldn't use much shorter outboard with fat because they basically have similar center of pressure to normal smoothie blades, and they a little bit more difficult to handle, and that's a point you have to. It requires certain rowing technique. That means fast catch, quite good skills of handling the oar because they're much wider, and this inefficient technique, you can lose more with them because it takes more time to square them, more space and more time to put it under the water. They drag more water out at the finish. So you need skills to handle them. But from, I think the combs looks quite promising, quite efficient, but it's not final answer. We're still working on efficiency, hopefully in a couple of months, it'll be more clear.
Thank you. Yes.
Yeah, just summarizing rowing style factor and catch factor here for the winners of Olympic Games, you see my estimation that most of them, they have optimal, the rowing style in optimal range somewhere 90-100%. One exception is Croatian men's pair. They definitely exception. They opened the trunk very, very early. A sort of DDR style, or I don't know, Adam style, they close to that. And here I counted only four crews where we have, I would estimate the catch factor is positive. And 10 crews, they have, my estimation, they have negative catch factor, which is, I think, more efficient. This is my analysis of Olympic Games. Hopefully you have all handouts and you can download them, and if you are interested, you can watch all crews, the clips, and see the analysis of their technique. And that would be probably it. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm not sure if you have time for questions. I would be really happy to answer if you have time.
Yeah, we have one here, at least to start. For the finish through the handle concept, at what point during the stroke cycle should the pressure on the stretcher end?
My answer is very simple. The later, the better. So keep pushing the stretcher as long as possible during the drive. Because when you stop pushing the stretcher, that's it. The drive is finished. That means you have no force, no support at the pin in the middle of the oar. If you pull the handle, basically what happens, you simply, it all comes to internal force again. There is no blade force without stretcher force. That's very simple. To provide blade force, we need pair of force, handle and the stretcher. It's absolutely compulsory. Without stretcher force, it's not possible. You can experiment it very well. If you put your feet on the top of the stretcher or some on the canvas and just try to pull the handle, you will see that you just move the board, but you won't move the whole system. The whole system stays on the same place without stretcher force. So it's I think it's absolutely compulsory to emphasize the stretcher push. And I know many good coaches, the best coaches, they put a lot of emphasis on the stretcher. They talking about work through the stretcher, keep pushing the stretcher, stay on the stretcher, don't push, put your weight on the seat, suspend your weight from the seat, and hang on the handle, these sort of things.
Great, thank you.
Well, we have a few more minutes for questions if anybody out there has any, if you want to throw them in. Valerie, this has been great. Thanks so much for joining us this morning. Well, it's not morning where you are, is it?
Now it's nearly 4 p.m. in UK, but that's okay. It's good time.
Anybody have any questions they want to ask Dr. Klezhnev? Awesome. Well, thank you so much for joining us. It's always great having you on. Look forward to the next time already.
Yeah. If you forward question by email, I would be really happy to answer. Always happy to help you guys.
Definitely.
Well, I think we're going to go through with the prize for the team that had the most coaches involved. We're going to get some of your angle finders. So we're going to make that a prize. It'll be fun to send that out to a team.
Okay.
So OKC Riversport, I'm putting that plug in.
Thanks, Chris.
We do have a question right here. How do you feel about the tight rigging?
What do you mean, tight rigging? The span shorter. Well, again, it must be optimal. When you make it tighter, that means it's heavier, that because you change basically geometry of how the arms connected to the shaft, and the narrower span makes it angle sharper, and that means you may have longer angles, but it's heavier gearing basically. Yeah, and also that in sculling and in CPRO, it's limited by overlap. That means tighter span or spread means shorter inboard, it means heavier. Yeah.
So It'll certainly change. Oops, sorry.
Yeah, it must be optimal. Very simple. Yeah.
It'll change the balance a little bit too, won't it? A big focus of this conference is long-term athlete development and questions surrounding how do you teach younger kids how to row? You know, even pre-12-year-olds. Have you done any studies on optimal lengths of oars or blades? Or anything of that nature for the smaller, the tiny kids, or the kids that are 6 to 12 years old.
Well, of course, the oars must be shorter, and that's very common question, because if you look at other sports and skiing or cycling, they have equipment proportional to the dimensions of the athlete, right? In bikes, frame size or ski size, whatever. In rowing, but the difference is they are individual sports. You basically, they buy equipment for this specific athlete, young kid or adult or whatever. Rowing is a club sport, team sport. We have boathouse, and very often we use the same oars, the same boards for kids and for masters and for elite rowers. They usually have their own equipment, but very often we use the same equipment for athletes of different dimensions. That's the nature of rowing, right? And that's why we have very conservative sizes of the equipment. And practically it's very difficult, you know, to find. I would say for kids 10, 12 years old, they should use oars somewhere like a little bit more than 2 meters, like 240, 250, like Paralympic rowers, because they're really tiny creatures. So, but where you can get that oars? And that means you have to order them, buy them, spend money, and then you can use them only for kids. Then you need to change them when they grow up, you need to another equipment. It's expensive and it requires space in the board house to store that equipment, all that practical problems, you know. That's why we have not much choice and simply try to make it lighter gearing for kids, make it oars as short as possible, longer outboard, shorter outboard, longer inboard, lighter gearing. Yeah, but it's anyway, you are limited with longer inboard.
You know, with my sons, when they were 5 or 6, I bought them the short oars, and it was worth the investment. If you're I feel like if you're going to do it right with those younger kids, you need to make your best effort to make it optimal for them, because you want them to stay in the sport. But now some questions are coming in, Valerie. Is there an optimal rowing style for those young rowers, for middle school or young kids? Do you feel there's an optimal?
I think the basic principle stays the same for everyone. You have to teach them. In my experience, I spent sometimes with kids and with my son, and I try to teach him straight away good catch factor, acceleration of the body center of mass. But of course, for them, many other things are also important, like a posture. You have to keep your trunk straight and strong, you know, otherwise you have injuries, you know, they have very weak muscles and not stable spine. So probably the first of all, you have to teach very basic things, how to sit in the board, how to maintain posture, how to, you know, oar angles, positions, you know, stationary. But also from very beginning, you can teach the efficient rowing style and just keeping in mind that that point for kids, injury prevention, yeah.
Yeah, so important, right? I mean, you know, we've had a lot of talks this weekend already about strength and conditioning and all the reasons why you would do it for younger kids. People are a little bit freaked out by the idea that you're gonna teach younger athletes to lift, but strength and conditioning is actually injury prevention if you're doing it right.
And just one more comment. In my experience, that very often the efficient rowing style, they learn it very quickly, they learn it better than adults, than elite row, because they don't have much muscles on upper body. And that fast legs drive works really well for them, you know, because and then when they grow bigger, they put more muscles on shoulders, on arms, and they try to use that muscles. And very often they change rowing style and it became more inefficient. That's what we saw. Very often the rowing style is more efficient in young kids than in elite rowers, simply because they don't have a lot of muscles, they don't have power, they have to be efficient, you know, to be successful.
And you know, it's funny when you mentioned that, I think the younger kids, it's more intuitive how the body needs to do something correctly, you know, whether it be when they're really little and there's all these pictures of toddlers lifting things up and they've got perfect form. And I think the smarter we get, the dumber we get, right? We overthink things, and that's why I think also rigging is probably very important for them, because they're going to try to do it. And if you've rigged them heavy or rigged them too long or incorrectly, you're going to be the reason they might pick up some dings in their body. I hate to say this, but we've run out of time. Eric has put in Dr. Klezhnev, your email. We have some questions left. Is it okay if they email you?
Of course.
So we encourage you all to if those of you who still have some questions, sorry we couldn't get to them, but we don't have much time between the presentations, and the next presenter has to get into this room and try out their slides and make sure the videos work and all that. So, Doctor, thank you for joining us. It's great to see you.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thanks.
Happy New Year.
Yeah, Happy New Year to you too. Thanks.
Bye-bye. Okay, everybody. Take care. Have a good one.